Okay, so I haven't introduced myself yet, but I'm Colonel Julie Boyd. I'm the Director for Military Personnel Operations at the Air Force's Personnel Center. And we're very thrilled to be here with you. We had a great session with your enlisted counterparts and with your force support squadron. I tell you, I said this before, but I really mean it. I mean, the enlisted members that you sent to that town hall, they were phenomenal. They had incredible questions. They were so respectful. They were just a good group. And I'm sure that we'll continue to see that the rest of the day, too. But we are here to spend some time with you and get your feedback, so don't be shy. Either on the meeting polls or in person, don't be shy. Next slide. So we're going to talk about several things in this next hour and a half. Hopefully this is of value to you. But before we get into any of it, General Toth, the commander of AFPC, he has come out on many of the roadshows. He couldn't make this one. He's in Alaska right now, having a good time on leave. But if he were here, let me tell you, he'd be showing you this next slide. Can we go back?
That is a,
wait, what's happening? Hit that slide. Whoever's at it.
There we go.
Anybody seen that before? It's a couple of you seen it, yeah, on Facebook or something, or Airmen and COs and UNCO page, yeah. Yeah, it's good, but we show it because what we're trying to say is we understand that that might be the perception, but I can tell you, at least over the last 2 years that I've been stationed at AFPC, we've worked really hard to become more transparent, to be more responsive to the field, to really change the culture that led to this. When I was stationed there as a captain, it was a lot more science-based, right? It was, what does the AFI say? Now, and I can tell you as a director at AFPC, I empower my team, and I've been empowered by General Toth to find the art, to balance that all that science and those rules and all that, to find out how can we apply some art, how do we get to yes, how do we take care of airmen and their families, how do we get to what the commanders really want us to do, and we think much more openly about how we can get there than we ever have before. And this has been a true cultural shift, and that's one of the reasons why we're out here on the road in the first place. Next slide. Before we get any further, I want to make sure we introduce you our command chief. Chief Hoagland has been on the ground at AFPC as our command chief for about 60 days, and he has some great insight to share with you. And please, let's give him a warm welcome.
Hey, I want to stall on this real quick, because we can replace those stripes with bars, right? How many of you in this room agree with me? Over the years, you thought this was the perception of AFPC. That, hey, what we do is we sit behind these cubicle wars and we have these spreadsheets, and every one of those spreadsheets and pointy talkies end up as a no. And then the easiest thing to do is, hey, let's just send the airmen something on CMS that they can't even understand, and let's regurgitate a bunch of AFIs and DOTIs and some of that policy BS stuff to confuse them in hopes that they just go away. And then they'll stay at Minot for 15 years, they'll stay at Whiteman for 22 years. Let me tell you, as a non-personnellist coming into the seat, this is not the case. I had the absolute humbled opportunity to walk through the hallways of about 2,600 steely-eyed warriors, both uniform wearers and our civilian teammates, that execute an incredible job every single day, because it's a culture swing that we brought to AFPC, and everybody is on board. Here's what I need you, as a lot of CGOs sitting in this room, is the fact that your airmen, right, go home every night potentially thinking this. I need you to be transparent. I need you to be able to provide them feedback. But use your leadership to pick up the damn phone and call, okay? I'm going to foot stomp that. Pick up the phone and call. I'm talking the left of bang, right? If we are the right of bang, then we are too late as frontline supervisors and leaders of the United States Air Force. So get real with them, get in the trenches, and move forward. One last foot stomp. As you'll see across our banner, we believe in agility, innovativeness, and responsiveness. Some might chuckle on the responsiveness from your Air Force Personnel Center. But let me tell you something. We got a couple of NCOs that cover down on a pool of about 39,000 individuals that they have to cover down on assignment actions. So overseas returnees, get ready to go across the pond, DSD, 29,000 individuals. But rest assured, if you push something, if you call, if you submit something, and that team member comes back to you and says, sir or ma'am, we're on it, we're getting after it, rest assured that they are. Give it a little bit of time before you pick up again and start throwing haymakers at us, but we are absolutely getting after it. So give us a little patience on that. And if you're ever through Randolph, come by the center, grab those youngsters, give them a huge hug and a fist pump, and tell them thank you, because they're rocking behind the scenes. Thanks for the invite and hospitality.
else, that's where we see ourselves squarely. We see AFPC right there in everybody else. We are here at AFPC to help enable your mission every day. That's why we exist. Next slide. A visual of that is that inverted triangle, right, that we have seen. John Wolfing refers to it as a servant leader, right? But we also look at it as we are there visually to support airmen and commanders in the field. That's why we exist. General Toth, if you were here, he'd also use this as an opportunity just quickly to delineate roles and responsibilities. Our half teammates, and I say that very sincerely, our teammates at the Pentagon, they established the policy and strategy for the A1 enterprise and for talent management. And at AFPC, we execute that policy on their behalf, right? We work with them closely. They do seek our input and advice, and sometimes we even make ghostwrite AFIs, et cetera, to give them something, to give them ideas of what could be executable by us. But at the end of the day, they set the policy and we execute it. So we're often waiting with the catcher's mitt for that policy to come down from our senior leadership, and we're doing our level best to communicate status with the field. But it's a team effort. Our A1 enterprise tries to work together to support airmen in our families and the commanders in the field, because that's why we exist. Next slide. That's why we're out here too. We're at this AFPC roadshow thing. I don't know how many of you have ever been to a roadshow before. Anybody? A couple people have been before. We've had a pretty long hiatus because of sequestration, right? We didn't have the funding to go out and do it. But when General Toth took over as commander, he said, hey, we need to get out there. We need to hear what's on the airmen's minds. We need to get their feedback. We need to put our word out there about all the different initiatives we're working on in the talent management and airmen care solutions. We need to get that stuff out to the field, and you only do that by having that analog conversation, this type of interaction like we're having today and this afternoon. We have three tailored messages. We spent time with the Force Support Squadron. This morning we spent time with the squadron commanders, shirts, and chiefs. We just finished a town hall with the enlisted members. Like I said, that was excellent. And we'll have another one this afternoon with our civilian counterparts, too. So tailored messages for all those, and it's designed to, again, be as transparent as we can with the field, to tell you what we're working on, and to give you feedback. Next slide. Next slide. Who's heard of this? A couple of you have. That's great. What have you been hearing? Thumbs up? What are you hearing? Is it working on? Huh?
Hard to get to.
Hard to get to. Like limited quotas type of thing? Okay. Well, that's good feedback. What I will do is I will take that back too, because we do this through the MATCOM A1 teams. And so what we do is we give Global Strike a quota, and then we expect them to distribute it as they see fit. We don't tell them how to distribute it. We just tell them, here's your quota, and please make it happen. So I will take that back to Colonel Pike. Let her know that maybe give Whiteman a little love. Is that fair?
So not just here. I came here from good votes, the same thing there. So
okay.
My sense is it's across the command.
Okay. So we'll share that. Thank you for saying that, because again, we give it to the MATCOMs, and then we don't really tell them how to schedule it. We just give it to them, and they give us the names. It's basically how it works. And we do the quota distribution based on population of the MATCOM. A couple courses ago, we added superintendents based on the feedback from the attendees. They said, hey, I'd love to have my superintendent here with me, and that was great feedback. And so we adjusted the whole agenda. We had specific targeted things for the superintendents, but we also had them side by side with each other. So super, super successful. So we are doing that going forward. That's how we're going to operate. And we also added three more courses this year we weren't planning on doing based on the demand. We're also scheduling, we did the 2020 review, and we're going to have 8 classes next year, which we were never intending, but it's just the demand is so high. But I think that tells you it's successful, because people are really eager to hear about the talent management initiatives that we're working on at AFPC. They're eager to talk to the subject matter experts directly. They want to meet their assignment officer in person. They want to walk the assignment floor. They want to see the boardroom. They want to go in and see where all these decisions are made. They want to spend time, you know, going through in a academic setting, an enlisted force distribution panel before going out and doing it for real. So those are the things we do with this course. It's not meant to replace the MATCOM commander's course or the AD course that's working, but it has been it's very focused on talent management and what AFPC does to execute A1 policies. Okay, so if you haven't heard about it, there it is. And thank you for that feedback. We'll definitely take that for action and work with our A1s. Thank you for that. Next slide. We're on social media. Who's been following us? Anybody? Look at that. Big goose egg. I encourage you to do it. We're on YouTube. We're on Facebook. We now probably need to get on Instagram because probably none of you are. I don't even know if that's possible. I'm not on Instagram, but we'll have to see. But there is a lot of really good information out there. We push as much information out as we possibly can, so it's out there for you to grab. One example that I actually used myself the other night in prepping for this roadshow is we have there's a 23-minute video on YouTube that is all about the line of the Air Force reconfiguration. That proposed change, because I don't think they came out to Whiteman, did they? The town halls that came out and described the whole competitive category, line of the Air Force, do you guys?
They did not.
They did not come out, right? So just because they didn't come out doesn't mean you can't learn as much as possible about it. It's out on YouTube. You can call it up. It's 23 minutes long, like I say. And you've got the script, you've got the slides, you hear the voiceover, you can hear everything about it that's being proposed. It's almost like they would have come here. So that's out there right now, and I encourage you, if you haven't, to take a look at it. That's just one example. Military and civilian topics are out there. Highly encourage you to think about it and take it. And maybe you're having a mentoring session in your flight or in your work center. This could be a topic. You could pull one of those up, watch it real quick, and have a discussion about it. It's just a tool that you could use for you and your airmen. So I encourage you to check it out. And if there's something that's not on there that you want, we also want to hear that too. Okay? Next slide. Hey, one thing that's out there that's a really great tool is my Air Force benefits. And Chief Hogan, I leave it to him to talk this one up.
It's that guy again. So going back one slide previous to this, need your help. Here comes the intrusive leadership talk straight at you, being absolutely open and candid. A couple weeks ago on this site itself, only 4,000 hits Air Force wide. What this site provides our airmen, to include you, is a plethora of 150 up-to-date fact sheets for you and your airmen, from deployments to separations to PCS. And here's the cool thing. When it comes to the retirement aspect, it will actually pull your own specific data, such as your high, your 10-year, what retirement program you're under, and it will spit out, no kidding, your benefits. So anybody that's looking at separating or retiring, don't waste your money by going out and buying one of these retirement calculators out on Apple, whatever it might be. But here's where I really need you when it comes to the social media aspect, all right? As everybody knows, especially if you're an operator here, I see a couple is, you know, from the mission planning standpoint, a successful operation is hinged on an information operation campaign, right? So that's AFPC's mindset. The more that we can get out on social media, the more we can get out to the lowest level and in the trenches to give you opportunities on social media to interact with them, to me, is winning. Slow is steady, and steady is winning. So I ask you, snapshot this, go back, pass it to everybody that you know, your left, right, front, and center, sit down with your airmen. The one thing I don't want them to be caught off, we are riding on an Army URL right now. I apologize. We are the greatest Air Force in the world, but Army got to it first, so we're just kind of riding on their heels. Half A6 CIO is hopefully going to make a decision that we can switch it over to Air Force URL. But please, help us out on the social media aspect. Generation Z entering the workforce are awesome at social media. And some of us sitting in this room need to jump on board with that too, to be able to relate and watch the success in the future. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you, Chief. Okay. General Tope sends out every other week a biweekly communication, a strategic communication, if you will, about officer, enlisted, and civilian issues that we're working. Anybody seen this before? Anybody ever get it pushed down to you at your level? Wow, nobody. Well, it's not meant to be that way. It's sent to the force support squadron commanders, and then the next day it's sent to all the wing commanders and A1s and J1s.
That has come out, ma'am. So
oh, it does? Okay.
Jake is brand new, but Gina before him was pushed
okay.
out.
Okay. So it does get pushed out?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Well, that's good to hear. Because that's the intent. The intent is for this to be pushed out to the masses. Actually, and we talked with your leadership team earlier today about, is there a different way we can deliver it? Because it's not unusual to not see a lot of hands go up in the air when we have a roadshow. Because we spend a lot of time and effort to putting these things together, and we want them to be of use. But if they're not being pushed down, do we need to look at other ways to do it? So it is nice when the senior leaders, the wing commander, etc., can put a little emphasis item, a little push on that email. Maybe you'll be more likely to read it than if it was some sort of automated push. we'll be talking through that with General Toke if we need a readdress. But the information within it, if you do get it, I encourage you to take a look at it, at least in the areas that are of interest to you. Okay?
We are getting that. And
okay.
I think commanders and chiefs are getting that. I'll take it over and we'll work to push that out further because I do get the students. There's a lot of good info.
Okay, great. Thank you. I don't know if you heard of me said you'd take that one for action here locally. But again, like I say, it's not incredibly unusual for us to get that kind of feedback. So this is something we need to kind of murder board a little bit and see if we can do better, because there's so much time and effort by all of us here sitting in the front to make these valuable to you. Next slide. Okay, next we have a couple of hot topics that we want to go through, and I want to introduce my awesome superintendent, Chief Baxter.
Yeah.
Thank you. Good afternoon. How are y'all doing?
Good, ma'am.
Good. You guys awake?
Yeah.
Awesome. So, as Kermwood said, I am Chief Baxter. I'm the superintendent of military personnel operations, and it's an honor to be here to talk to you a little bit about some of the things happening at AFPC. I definitely don't do it alone, and we have a good team here with us, and I want to point out a couple of individuals. We have Chief Master Sergeant Chad Pryor. He is the DP3 superintendent. He handles policy. So anything policy related or process owned, that he is the one that will be able to answer those questions. I have Master Sergeant Fox with us. She's our assignment NCO, because a lot of the questions that we get when we're on the road show pertain to assignments, right? So we bring her along to answer those specific questions. And then we also have Technical Sergeant Crane. She makes sure that those questions you guys are asking and the ones that we're answering, that we actually take those back, kind of compile them together, and make sure that we provide it out there for others to be able to view them. Okay? Like I said, from your perspective, our goal is really, as leaders, we want you to be able to take this information and help educate your team. Okay? And we know from your perspective, you'll be able to do that and send that message that we want. Next slide, please. How many of you have heard of EPME self-registration? A couple of folks, right? This is a huge, huge movement for the enlisted, right? And we are excited about where we're going for PME. In the past, you may have heard that EPME, we decided when your enlisted airmen go to these particular courses, right? So, your chief will get, a date, and then they'll have to either attend the course, right, or they have to go ahead and do a deferment. What this process actually does, it allows the individual to select out of 3 dates. They get to prioritize whatever date they're available for by priority, and then provide that information back to our team, and then we'll go ahead and rank that and then provide them a date based on the information that they received. If you notice on the slide, it talks about for the chief leadership course, we just started this. We did this in July, right? We had 208 targeted messages go out to those individuals that it applied to. And out of that 208, we had 156 people respond back, and we were able to take care of their class dates based on their recommendations. And if you notice, very successful, right? Today we have 0 deferments. So we know that it's actually working, hence we're going to move forward and push it through for our senior NCO academy. We're working that currently right now, and then in December, we're going to move it out for the NCO Academy. Any questions on this slide? No? Okay. Next slide, please. Talking a little bit, sharing some information on incentivizing 365-day extended deployments. This opportunity gives the deployed member orders to their next installation 4 months in advance from departing for that 365, right? Keeping in mind that it's still a deployment, but providing the opportunity for you guys to take care of your families. So what does this do for you? It gives you the orders in hand 4 months in advance, then you're able to actually have the opportunity to actually move your family to your next installation before you actually deploy. They have the opportunity to actually move while you're deployed, because they have those orders, right? Or they can still wait until you get back to actually PCS to the next installation. So those options are definitely available. They're made available to help you and your family out in the event that you are selected or non-selected, right? If you're a volunteer or non-volunteer, officer or enlisted, this applies to you as well, right? For individuals, if you decide to move your family to that next place before you deploy, when you actually come back, you can go straight to that new base. You do not have to go to your old installation, your last installation and out process. Okay, so it provides that direct connection. Any questions for this right here? Again, really looking at the focus of taking care
365, you're not stressed out about how the family and everything is doing. All right, next slide. So joint spouse has been around. There's nothing new about the actual process itself in a sense of what is joint spouse. You know, we're in this particular sense, we're talking our mill-to-mill, right? Your Air Force mill-to-mill. And we want to make sure we express the importance that AFPC has on keeping families together. This is both on the officer and the enlisted side, right? So we want to make sure that at a minimum, we do our best to make sure that you are stationed within a 50 mile radius of each other. Now, that means that your joint spouse and tank code must be updated as well, right? So you have to make sure that your team is ensuring their joint spouse and tank code is intended for what they want, you know, whether or not they want to be with their spouse or not, right? Because that's how our assignment NCOs are actually working those assignments. Sergeant Bob, if she's working a joint spouse assignment, she's going to actually get up and actually walk to the other assignment NCO, and it happens on the officer side too, right? So there's going to be a discussion between those two AFSCs to see where to best utilize both of you. Now, in the event that you identify certain bases that you want to go to, but the joint spouse intent doesn't allow you to go to those bases, your joint spouse intent is going to take the priority, right? So what does that mean? That means if you guys have bases, you know, Midwest, I'll just say, you know, here, if you have bases listed as Florida, that kind of thing, and joint spouse will get you to Texas, we're going to make sure that we put you together and you're going to go to Texas, right? Just remember that your joint spouse intent code is the primary focus for joint spouse assignments, okay? One thing to mention about joint spouse as well is that in the past, to disapprove a joint spouse assignment, that was done at the branch chief level, and now it has been elevated to General Kelly, AFPC commander. He's the only one that can disapprove a joint spouse assignment for officer and enlisted. As of today, we're at a 98% approval rate. So when I talk about this, I like to ask, how many of you are joint spouse? Just raise your hand. Any joint spouse? Were we successful with this joint spouse assignment? Yes? And we really try to make sure that we do that, right? We are really intentionally looking at those bases to make sure that we keep you guys together. One thing that's not mentioned on the slide is we also, if you're, you know, mill to mill in your different service, sister service, our team also communicates with the sister service that's associated with the spouse to see if there's a way for us to align those assignments. So that does happen. It's done a little differently because of the sister service's processes, but for the most part, we have that communication at AFPC as well. Takeaway here is just know that we care about you and your family, right? You and your spouse, and we want to make sure that you guys do stick together within 50 miles of each other.
Chief, question real
quick.
This is probably more policy, maybe philosophy, future, whatever, but is there any discussion at higher levels about doing a joint spouse equivalent if you've got a GS spouse?
I'm Sharon Siever. I'm the Division Chief over Civilian Staffing, Recruiting, and Force Management. And so there is some working groups going on right now to address how we can best find those employment opportunities for those civilian spouses that are having to PCS. One of the things that they do have and has been expanded recently by President Trump is the Military Spouse Preference Program. So if they are, it's not done the same way as a joint spouse program with mill to mill, but it is a program that gives them priority opportunity for employment at their next location, or even if, let's say you have the 365 incentive employment incentive program going on, they could even go to the next duty station and get that. They don't have to wait for their spouse to join them before they can get that priority preference. So we did switch from our registration process for that, where they were limited previously to only certain career fields to on a registration platform. Now they can, it's wide open. They can apply for anything that they are interested in and what they think they may qualify for and exercise that preference. So a couple of initiatives going on that we're trying to get after that.
That's a great question, and there's one other thing to add, and you'll see this potentially in the talent marketplace demo that we hope to get to in a second, is while we're not quite to the point because we're still in the working group phase, what we are doing is we ask a joint spouse an intent question that says, are you married to a a civilian spouse, you know, Department of Defense employee, and then we provide information about things that Sharon was just talking about within Talent Marketplace, just as an information referral type of thing, so they know about what Sharon described. It's just one of the ways we're starting to inch our way into that piece. Good question.
Thank you. Any other questions for joint spouse? Oh, we got a couple of questions. Okay, sure. Go ahead. Yes, sir.
So if we have a joint spouse couple that are divorced, mill with kids, are they looking at that?
So what I would like to do is when Chief Hogan comes back, I'd like him to kind of address that question, because that is something that has come up previously. I will tell you that as of today, right now, there is no program identified that supports that specifically, but in AFPC, we can work with them on a case-by-case basis. Okay. So when Chief Hogan comes back, he has some more insight, because he speaks directly with the AFSO, which are the senior enlisted leaders, with Chief Wright, and so they'll be able to have some more information. I'll put him on the spot here in about 2 seconds.
Okay. I'd love to. So I got a foot stop. This is all pre-decisional. Okay. So I'll give you a little bit of Hogie perspective, and I'll give you an idea of where the Air Force is leaning on this. This is very much a Chief Master and Air Force priority and a General Wolfing priority of, hey, how do we get after this? About a month and a half ago, we provided 3 separate COAs of how we do this to General Kelly. For him and his team up there, Air Force A1 to socialize. You know, what is this going to look like? Do we assign parents a code, much like we do with the joint spouse aspect? How do we work the PCS budget? How do we work with MFMs and CFMs to make sure that a manning support so we can get the folks in the right direction? Now here comes the hokey piece, right? And let's really think about this. Who's to say that your ex-spouse wants you to come in the vicinity to where they currently are? And then 2, what if that ex-spouse had gotten remarried? What makes you think that the new spouse wants you, the old spouse, to come to the vicinity where they're currently being stationed at? So those are things we have to get through, very tactical in nature, right? And something that we as leaders can get through. But bottom line, we as the Air Force are taking this very seriously. I can't speak on behalf of the Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marines, but I don't think they're discussing this. But you got to look at the sheer volume of what the Army has compared to what we have. But what I do want to put stop is if you have airmen that are in that predicament, we had a young man today that we are currently, the team is battling working for them, we can work those eaches as we are looking for long-term policy moving forward. But your Air Force leadership is all over this. Trust me. Thanks.
Thank you,
Admiral. Thank you.
Information. In my experience going through the process, if it felt like I could
assignment in AFPC, you'll see that first bullet, accelerated PCS orders, right? Accelerated PCS orders was an initiative that started back in December where we wanted to try do a beta test. We started in Korea with providing orders 180 days prior to the projected departure date. Because we knew that in the past, people were within 30 days of PCSing and still didn't have their orders, right? That was a huge issue of concern for our airmen and their families. So we started in Korea, did this 180-day, you know, provided the orders. Now, the key thing here is we provided those 180 days prior to a projected departure, and you didn't have to fully complete your out-processing checklist. You still had to initiate the checklist, right, to show that you were starting the out-processing, but you did not have to complete all your out-processing actions in order to receive these orders. So we went through that beta test in Korea. Then we picked up the JBSA area, right, Joint Base San Antonio area, and we allowed that process to work within JBSA. Learning that it was definitely something positive, not having any negative feedback from Korea, we decided to go ahead and push this out Air Force-wide. Now, as I mentioned, our goal is to truly get out to 180 days. As of today, right now, we are at the 60-day prior to projected departure date. So 60 days prior to your projected departure date, you should have orders in hand. Right? This will definitely help you facilitate your move, take care of you and your family, make those appointments, get housing in line at your next duty station, but really focusing on making sure there's alleviating some of that stress that was out there in the past. Hopefully, you know, once the budget's approved and we go through, you know, the fiscal year, we'll be able to approve it to where we push it to 90 days prior to projected departure date and get your orders, right? With the ultimate goal of, you know, reaching that 180-day point. Keeping in mind, too, that, you know, out-processing is important, right? I don't know that I foot stop this enough, but as we're giving these orders to you and your airmen, we really need you guys as leadership to get involved to ensure that the airmen are out-processing, that you guys are actually doing the out-processing, right? So you're not showing up at the next installation and we have some issues going on with what you've cleared through and what you haven't cleared through, okay? So as leadership, we do want your involvement in making sure that out-processing checklist is done prior to you actually out-processing the installation. Now, as good as this program is, it may not apply to everybody, okay? There's certain instances with EFMP, right, Exceptional Family Member Program. You know, our focus there is to make sure that you and your family are clear to go to the next installation, you know, and they have the medical support. So providing you accelerated orders may not be an option for us, right? And then again, PRP, the Personal Reliability Program. We want to make sure that you have the proper clearance and you're clear to go to that next assignment. So those are two situations where accelerated orders may not work for you and your airmen. But we're doing this. It's working very well. We just need your help in making sure that no kidding out processing is currently happening once you initiate that checklist. Okay. Any questions? Yes, sir. So we started out with Korea, right? We did start out with Korea, and then we moved to JPSA, but this is pushed Air Force wide. Air Force wide, no kidding, 60 days out from PDD, projected departure date, you should be able to get your orders in hand. So then I would ask this question. How many of you are within 60 days of your projected departure date and do not have your orders? So we have one individual. Two individuals. Okay, when's your projected departure date?
I don't know,
40 days. 40 days. Where are you going?
Do you want to go out to PC?
Okay. And what about you? Okay. If I could have you all just join us at the end here, and we'll get your information out in front of you and see where you're all at. Anyone else? Any other questions with accelerated orders? On this last bullet here, excuse me, it talks about early notification of assignments from commanders. That 7-day notification prior to a member getting notified of assignment. How many of you are aware of this program? 7-day notification. Okay. So, you know, I stress here, you know, as leaders, we need to make sure that, you know, we're doing our best to give the commanders that 7-day time period, right, so they can have that discussion, one with the airmen, to let them prepare their families, you know, for the upcoming PCS, and two, as a commander and a leader, it's to help prepare the organization
for that individual PCSing as well, right, to make sure that they cost the organization correctly. It is not the opportunity for, you know, you or your airman to have that discussion about, you know, not going on assignment, right, or a negotiation strategy to not PCS, okay? Merely it is the opportunity to, you know, provide the commander with that information ahead of time to help the organization and the members transition.
Chief,
yes.
Question. I don't understand the ones and zeros, but if I could offer, I guess it's probably more of an opinion. A lot of times what I see is I get the 7-day advance notice, and the member is already on a gains roster. So if there is a way to change the ones and the zeros to where that gains roster doesn't reflect them leaving or coming, I guess in this case leaving, until the member gets the, I guess 7 days later is what I'd be looking for. I have people that have access to milk PDS in my unit, and they're always scanning to help with sponsorship packages and everything else, and sometimes they'll find out before I'll even get the notice that there's a 7-day email.
Okay. Let me respond to that. Did you want to respond to that?
Ma'am, just to piggyback on
okay.
that, in coming here, I got calls pretty much the day that dropped from people here talking to people they knew at Kirtland, where I came from, and saying, hey, you just showed up on the inbound here, and that was my experience. It wasn't an earth, you know, shattering thing for me or a real problem, but that's how that played out. I didn't end up getting that conversation because that's what happened.
Okay, so I kind of want to address two things with that, and I thank you for both bringing that up, right? We know that there is a concern with commanders not given the opportunity to have that 7-day window, right? And we do also understand that individuals that have no PDS access have the, you know, visibility to see that gains roster, right? So as a no PDS access and or user, we have the responsibility to make sure we are not providing that information to anyone but the commander for that 7 days. It's a role and responsibility that we have as, you know, 3F0s, 3F5s, or UPCs, right, program managers. So I would say, you know, from a two different aspect, you know, whoever the users are for that, we have to find a way to hold them accountable for not providing that information. And then we as airmen, if we know that we're going to another, you know, we know somebody has an assignment, we have to make sure that we're not, you know, making phone calls and taking that, I guess, that privilege from the commanders, right? Because they should be the ones communicating with the losing unit and, in turn, being the first to find out on that. But if ones and zeros, you mentioned, if there's a way to ones and zeros, I would say, you know, and this is Rebecca Baxter's perspective, right? When it comes to the personnellists or the 3F5 that's behind that nil PDS access there, they need to be held accountable to making sure that they're providing that information in the right way. And if they are not providing that, then we need to make sure we have a discussion on, hey, you know, the commander does have the authority to release that information. You don't necessarily, you shouldn't be sharing that with anybody else. But the ones and zeros, systematic-wise, I'm not sure if is that something that, we're not.
No, I mean, essentially it's what we've done in order to implement this. When General Kelly charged us with, and this was almost 2 years ago, he said, hey, I want to give, just like early promotion releases we want, instead of them finding out on a website, instead of them, in this case, finding out on BMPF they have an assignment, we want to give the commanders the opportunity, the privilege to make these notifications, right? And with our system, as antiquated as it is, what we ended up doing is basically having a 7-day delay before it'll hit BMPF, but it's still in MIL-PDS because that's how assignments are loaded. So that is the, I guess, loophole, is people with MIL-PDS access. And we kind of accepted that as a risk. It got us to where, for the 98% of the Air Force, that works for. But we have gotten that feedback before, and I think it might be time for our internal 38Fs, Force Support Officers, and our enlisted members that have MIL-PDS access to re-emphasize that this is for the commander to make those notifications.
Yeah, I don't disagree with what you said, Chief, but I think human behavior, if we can offset that some, and, you know, there's so many variables on who has access, and so I can control it to a certain extent, right? I can tell people, here's what I expect, but if there was just a way to change that a little bit and give us, I think it works great for staffs and below, but once you get tech and above, like, I see senior NCOs that get called from MAJCOM headquarters because they know who their replacement is, you know. So, and I'd argue that those are probably the most important people that we should be having a 7-day option discussion with. The airmen, that all works itself out with NCOs being involved, and I think that none of them at that level of the NCO tier are going to have no
and sir, I would tell you that if there was something that we could do the system right now like this and would happen that quick, that'd be great for us. But unfortunately, the way our systems and our processes work, it's not an overnight action
sure.
for system updates. So we have to utilize the processes that we have in place and how to manage those things.
Thank you for the feedback.
So,
appreciate it.
Any other questions, concerns with the 7 days or anything? This here is what we call PERSTAT, personnel statistics. Has anyone here heard of thermos? Hands up. Okay, you smile. Why are you smiling? Sorry.
Where'd he go?
Yeah, where did he go? So thermos was a system, a database, if you will, that kind of gave you a snapshot of manning, right? Manning, so you could go to this, you know, this system and it would tell you how many vacancies they had or how many. The unfortunate thing about thermos, though, it wasn't as accurate because it wasn't updated on a continual basis. This is updated monthly by our team at AFPC. And what this does is you can go out here to this link and you can create a report. And within this report, you can, you know, it's very very diverse. You can select different categories, criteria, base, installation, geographic locations, and you can build it to what you want to visually see. And this is a good option for you to kind of take a look. It gives you a holistic approach of no kidding manning. Now, what I will be honest with you in saying is it's still by community, AFSC community, right? So it's not broken down specifically to the shred out of the AFSC, but it does talk about the community as a whole. We are improving this. The team is working on making adjustments to this, but I will tell you, if you utilize thermos, this is definitely the replacement for thermos, and this gives you no kidding up-to-date monthly information. And we wanted to make sure that we provided that to you as leaders. The enlisted, we did receive, after I was done with the enlisted briefing, the enlisted airman came and asked, you know, what replaced thermos, because I did not brief this during the enlisted side of the house, so I would ask if you could make sure you share that with your team, that'd be awesome, and we'll make sure we get these slides to them as well. Okay? All right. Any questions on this? Okay, next slide, please. For enlisted evaluations, it's, you know, timeliness has always been a concern of ours, right? We want to make sure for our enlisted force that the reports are received to AFPC, and they're received to AFPC in the timeline and the suspenses that are provided for you all. If we could get your support in making sure that those reports are coming through, you know, the different levels so they can get in the individual's records in a timely manner, that would be, you know, spot on. Second and third order effects of when it doesn't get in their records on time, it causes supplemental consideration, right? Although they are still going to be considered, it's at a later date, right? So that's one disadvantage to the member. Additionally, when you go through supplemental consideration and if you are selected, you know, there is a delay in pay. So that does then affect the member and their families. And then, you know, lastly, but not least important, is the fact that, you know, if a report is going through the wicked slate, then the airmen, right, they're not receiving timely feedback from you and your leader. So we ask your support in making sure that we, you know, you do a good push on getting those reports in time so we can minimize the supplemental promotions, the supplemental considerations, the awards, and to, you know, provide that timely feedback for the end. Any questions? As with enlisted evaluations, they do affect promotions, right? But one thing I want to share with you is it's really great to see that, you know, commanders, you have the distinct advantage of, you know, promoting somebody by giving them a promote now or must promote, right? So that does provide the airman with a distinct advantage for promotion. I would also like to say that, you know, for communication purposes, if your airmen are talking about, you know, or feeling, you know, disappointed by receiving a promote, I would, you know, show you these data points right here, and you can just focus in on the 1987 results at the top there. Center column really looks at the number of folks that were selected, right? You'll see that the promote nows, 23% of those promote nows were selected. It doesn't say 100% of the promote nows were selected, right? So it's 23%. So the airman still has to do their part to make sure that they are selected for promotion. But you as the commander give the distinct advantage to them by providing them with that promote now. Send those with their most promote. Identifying specifically for the promote, 42% of those were select. 42% of the promotions were those that received the promote. That's still, I mean,
mean, those data points in itself do show that. It shows you that, no kidding, you do not have to get an MP, must promote or promote, not get promoted. With a promote, you can still do your part and still get that stripe. Any questions? Okay. Next up, we have Captain Hazan. He's going to talk to you a little bit about talent marketplace.
Sorry, I didn't answer the question. Hi everyone, good afternoon. I'm Paul Hazan. I work at AFPC in DP2 on, I'm not an actual assignment officer, an AO, but I work very closely with all the AOs at AFPC. We have a team of 88 assignment officers on the floor that I work in, and they're from each and every single one of you, the AFSCs. So just keep that in mind as what goes in the care, the scrutiny for matching officers to assignments. So basically, Talent Marketplace is the new team, the new human resource system that we're bringing online. I wouldn't say it's a system, it's actually an application that runs on the MyVector platform. And so, how many people have used Talent Marketplace in the past? All right, okay, cool. So this is the application that we're bringing on board to replace AMS, which is the old legacy system. And that system has been out there for over 20 years, so it needed some overhauling, and we're doing that. So I want to go ahead and take some time to show you a couple slides of where we're at. As I said, we're working closely with your assignment teams. So there's three things that we get from the field. We get your input as far as your assignment intent and preferences. When that window opens up, you are able to go out on the Talent Marketplace and update the application with your intended preferences. And we're going to show you a demonstration of how that goes after this these two slides. But it also takes into account the game commander's needs. So right now, we are in the summer 2020 cycle, assignment cycle, and we also have the officer, instructor, and recruiting special duty cycle out there on Talent Marketplace, and it is important that you pay attention to the windows that are open out there. And I would highly recommend that you write this down: the Air Force Officer Assignment System Timeline. Go out to MyPERS and download that, because it gives you key dates about when you can go out and update your assignment intent and preferences. And so, as I was saying, right now we are in the window of requisitioning. So if you're a billet owner, most of the time that's squadron commanders. So how many billet owners do we have in here? All right, so you're actually in the requisition phase of that timeline. So as I said, that's why it's important to make sure that you pay attention to those timelines, because the capabilities in the system, it's a role-based system. So those open up in the system and coincide with that timeline. So certain tiles will be available for you to log into, and that all depends on those dates, those key dates in the timeline. All right. So what it does, as I said, this is a tool that your assignment officers, you along with your commanders, are using to meet Air Force requirements. So we can also, through this tool, increase transparency about your desirable for locations that you want to go to. So it makes it more visible. This system makes it, and you'll see in the demonstration, that it makes it more visible for you to be able to outline what bases or what positions that you would like to go to. You're able to better communicate that to your commanders and the officer assignment teams at the AFPC. And so, as I said, that gives us visibility on what your assignment intent preferences are. And for the first time, this is really different from how AMS used to be in the past, is it allows the billet owners to go out there and search other officers and to bid on those officers. So that's a new functionality that has been incorporated into the Talent Marketplace system. So bidding is kind of a neat feature, and we'll show that to you. All right, so next slide. All right, so this is just a quick snapshot of where we've been with Talent Marketplace. We came online last summer, and we just wrapped up the third assignment cycle in June, the winter 2019 assignment cycle with Talent Marketplace. And we found some data, but as I said before, we don't know exactly what this data means yet to us, because billet owners, that, for instance, that 45% of billet owners who participated received an officer they bid on. In the past, in AMS, we didn't have that ability to track billet owner bidding. So just keep that in mind as we move forward. And so now we are, all AFSCs are using Talent Marketplace, except for JAGs, because their assignments are still managed at the half. And so what we presently got going on in Talent Marketplace is we are, as I said before, we're hosting and advertising jobs for the officer instructor and recruiting special duty cycle that's currently going on, that kicked off on the 15th of July. And then we are also conducting a beta test in Talent Marketplace for the enlisted assignments piece. So we have the TACP Airmen in there right now, the ones returning from overseas. They are actually using Talent Marketplace so that we can get feedback from them and then find out kind of what Talent Marketplace is going to look like down the road for any enlisted assignments that may be managed in there. And then, but as far as automation goes, it's not going to be a gunculator that automates the assignment process. There's still, each assignment is looked at, as I said, with a lot of scrutiny, a lot of care. In matching an officer to a position. So it's not going to fully automate the assignments process. So that's what I got for those two slides. And then what I'd like to do now is I'm going to go ahead and jump into a demonstration on our test site. It's the site has data that's not fictitious data, but it mirrors the production site. So we'll go ahead and take a minute to just log in. While we're doing that, are there any questions?
Yeah. And actually, I just want to highlight, if you guys have been checking out the meeting pulse, so thank you for the asking the questions that you have been. That's been fantastic. The team and I have been trying to answer them as we go. So I just highlight that to you, that a lot of your questions have been, an attempt has been made to answer your question. But some of them, it's like, let's talk to you individually afterwards. It might be one of those kind of cases. Because again, whenever you ask a question, it's hard to know the context. And a lot of times with the officer side, depends on the AFSC, some of these answers to these questions, But what I will say is that all the assignment teams work for me, and what I would say is that I charge them to talk to you all. They should be calling you. They should be talking to your squadron commanders. And so, if like one of them was about basically 7-day option, would you work with me? And if you have special needs like that, we are in a retention mode right now. We want to retain as many officers as we possibly can, because we're trying to grow in strength, and we have valid Air Force needs out there. And so if we can do something applying the art instead of just the science, that we can, if we can make that those kind of things work, we do. And we call them saves. That's what we want to do. So I encourage you to communicate early and often when you have those special cases with your assignment team. Through your squadron commander, they can also advocate on your behalf. Communicate. Let us know so that we can see if we can find a win-win out there. Because I firmly believe there usually is one that we can find. Great job.
So I'm going to give you a demonstration of what this looks like when you have to go out there and that window opens up for you to update your assignment intent and preferences out there. So in this case, we're logged in as Captain Music, and you're just going to go into Mind Vector, and you're going to click the Talent Marketplace icon toward the top. Talent Marketplace toward the top. All right, you'll select the appropriate VML that you're on. And as I said, this is a role-based system, so if you are on a VML, it will, when it comes time for you to fill out the intent and preferences, this tile will populate, and you'll go in here to My Intent and Preferences, that tile. So that window for the summer 2020 cycle opens up on 1 October. And so this data that's at the top of the screen there, that profile data all comes from PDS. So if you notice anything that may be inaccurate, incorrect, you need to work with your local CSS or NPM to get that stuff updated in PDS, and they can take care of you. All right. And, but the important part of this screen is making sure that your supervisor information is up to date. So those blue buttons down there give you the ability to adjust that. So it's important to do that so that when it comes time for your losing commander to put comments in the system for you on the BML, that person is identified by you. So it's important that you make sure you update that appropriately. All right, so go ahead and click continue. And then we'll move to the next tab where we're updating the assignment intent question. So that kind of came up a little bit earlier about the joint spouse. So there, right now we have 12 global assignment intent questions, and they're in this tab. We ask things like, the joint spouse, is your spouse a civilian? Are you interested in a short tour overseas? Things like that can help the assignments teams make the best match when it comes time to match an officer group decision. So that's what that looks like. We'll fill those out, and then we'll go to the next. And there is actually that last question right there is pretty important too. That's free text building. If there's any special circumstances that you want the assignments team to be aware of, that's where you can communicate that to them. All right, so next. All right, and this is now a list of all the locations. Once it comes time to fill out this portion, all these locations have been requisitioned for and validated through the management level and higher headquarters at AFPC, your assignments teams, that they will be advertising jobs at those locations. So you can just scroll and see the list when that time or when that window opens, and then you can put a rating on the desirability for those locations, a 1 to 5, kind of like Yelp. It defaults to no stars, and that no star default means neutral. So, but we highly encourage you that you fill out the desirability rating on these locations as accurately as possible, because what we do and what we see, some of that is trend analysis based in nature, and we kind of look at, okay, where are the spots that are highly desirable, and what spots are least desirable. And based on some of that, those data points, there may be initiatives down the road. We've seen trends where Canon, of all places, believe it or not, is not a highly desirable place for a lot of AFSCs, which is unfortunate. But they may, down the road, with collecting data about that, offer a follow-on assignment incentive or possibly incentive pay. Nothing set in stone, but that's just something we need to look at. All right. And so, go ahead and click continue.
And Paul has a question.
Yes.
Sir,
yes.
Just on that previous page, there was a column right next to the stars that had different numbers in it.
Can we go back to the go back one tab? Yep, location.
Okay.
It's the number of billets that are available at that location. Yep. Alright, so click continue.
Yeah, keep asking questions as we go. We want this to be as interactive. We have another one over here, Paul.
Alright. So we're getting there. We're going to answer your question, ma'am. Yeah. So on that last tab is where you're going to be able to rank and stack what your actual references are. Okay.
This is more like Yelp or something. Is this a 1 star? But I don't really want to go there. Or 5 star? I would really like to go there if something's available.
Yes.
Does this only show if you're on the current email?
Yes. So you're only going to be able to fill this out when you're on the final email.
But that's not to say that we don't have an initiative going forward to have more of a perpetual, kind of like we have with the Airmen Development Plan and ADP today. Under the current development right now,
next tab, and it tells you exactly how many billets up there, 262 in this case, were advertised for this cycle. So you can use these dynamic filters that we built into the system to be able to drill down. You can, if you want to look at only captive billets, you can click on captive, and then if you want to the left, let's say you want to look at the ones in new safety, you can click on that. And then as you scroll down, it will narrow down the list of positions out there with the filters applied. And from there, you can basically favorite or star that position. So it's just a simple clicking on a blank star. If you see a position you like, you just star it. So that's that. And then, so scroll down and hit continue. And then this is, to answer your question, ma'am, the screen where you will actually do the final racket stack. So these are all the positions that you've favorited, and so it lists them there, and you can simply drag and drop to rearrange your priorities. And the interesting, or the neat feature of Talent Marketplace that we built in, is that that data is real time and changes as you drag and drop. So as the window is open and you're able to update your assignment intent and preferences, and you're able to rearrange this order, you can see that those there's only one person in this case. You favorited that position, and then one person has it in their top three, and then one person has it as, or as no people have it, as the no other people have it as their number one. So, and it changes real time. So, all right. So, and that's basically it from the VML officer standpoint. We can do a quick demonstration of the billet owner. Role, what they would do when it comes, yes.
So I have a question about that. Is this like the old system where if you put a short tour on there, the short tour trumps everything? Like you put a career on there, it kind of becomes like your most likely base to hit, even if it's like your number 10 or 12?
I wouldn't say that, no. I would say it's one of many inputs into the process. You know, the assignment teams work it lots of different ways, and I don't know, we're critical of you.
I was enlisted. I was emergency management.
Okay.
We've seen guys take the career as number 8,
oh, okay.
And they get picked up immediately.
Yeah, no, I would say no in this case. What we're trying to do, so often what a lot of the assignment teams do is they start off with their 05 requirements, rematch lieutenant colonels and below, right? And we don't have enough field grade inventory to fill all of the requirements, so we're going to start with most of the assignment teams do it that way, right? And they're trying to manage all those. And when they run out of lieutenant colonels on the VML, and they still have as many lieutenant colonel requirements that they have to fill, they're still looking at the majors. Almost based on requirements versus that, but all of those things will be factored in as we go. And the part about Talent Marketplace, which he's going to demo here in a second, I believe, is that billet owners would have, for the first time, input into this process, right? Old system, it was just the officer, what their preferences were, and then the assignment team did everything else, right? Now, billet owners can go out there, and he'll show you, can put bids on people on the VML. So we're also, not only are we trying to match the officer and their preferences and their professional development, but also what the billet owners want, who they want to bring into their team and try and find the matches. So to say short tour, maybe if a billet owner out there is at a short tour location and they're saying, hey, I want to hire somebody that wants to come here, somebody that 5-starred my location, somebody that is a short tour volunteer, that might be a good match. You know, but that to say that would trump automatically, there's so many other factors that go into it. It's definitely not, it's much more art than more of a science that you might have seen on the enlisted side. Okay, does that help?
All right, so I know we're running short on time. I know there's a few billet owners in here. I'll try to fly through this one a little bit quicker. But I just want to put it out there for reference that all this stuff, I know I mentioned a lot of things. It's actually out on our mail suite and our YouTube channel. So there's some pretty helpful videos for VML officers and billet owners using this system. All right, so real quick, we're logged in. We're about to log in as a billet owner, so click on that tile. And then you'll see all the positions that you own as a billet owner in your officer positions house, so in this case 78. And you can click on that to make any updates to job descriptions, TDY forecasts, specific requirements to that position from this tile. So scroll to the left, Mr. Evans, to that pencil edit icon on any one of these positions.
to the far left, the pencil icon.
Yep.
All right. So this is where the billet owners can see the information that's loaded on the position. A lot of that comes out of OPS, but some of this stuff is editable as a billet owner. Like I said, the mandatory qualifications, TY forecasts, things of that nature. So that's where you'll be able to go out and do that. All right. So this is get canceled. All right. And so scroll up and then go back to the billet owner dashboard. And then this is when the cycle is active, you'll also be able to see that, and you'll see that those buttons populate there, those blue buttons that, as a billet owner, to be able to manage your requisitions and to manage bids or to manage recalls. I don't want to take any more time, but as I said before, there we have some helpful tutorials out there. And if you have any questions, feel free to hit me up on email. Paul is on, so I can help you with things telemarketing.
Any other questions on that?
Yeah, I ask that you do ask questions. The only reason why is through the throughput into the enlisted following suits. We're taking all of your questions and the answers coming out as we define when we're going to go into Air Force Number 7 priority. So please ask for what our marketplace.
How much of what we put in there can the billet owners see?
So they are able to see kind of a quick snapshot of where you. So those. Location desirability star ratings, they can see that. They can also see any losing commander comments that were provided from your losing commander. And if your losing commander chose to give you a stratification for the cycle or where they rank you, that's optional. They can add that in there, but they can see that.
They also can see your CERC essentially in there.
Because updating the billet owner process right now, that's kind of one of those initiatives to automate. We've kind of semi-automated it, where we've built in functionality for the billet owner to log in and to add or remove themselves from billets that are assigned to them. They can remove themselves from the billets they're assigned to. They can add a replacement billet owner.
Okay. Anything
Okay, real fast. When we have till 2, is that right? Okay, and we do want to talk to line PRF and contact. So we're going to go real quick on this. Let's go to this program. Wounded Warrior? Really? Only just a couple of you? Or have you guys just, when you get, do some jumping jacks, wake you up a little bit? If you remember anything about Wounded Warrior, okay, is that this is a great program for wounded, ill, or injured airmen with the goal of getting them back to duty as soon as possible. So if you're out there, you're leading airmen, or if yourself is in this position where you're struggling a little bit and you need additional support resources, when in doubt, refer to Wounded Warrior. 14% of folks, over 9,800 folks that are enrolled in Wounded Warrior are not combat related. In other words, 86% are not combat related injuries or illnesses. So car accidents, cancer, sexual assault, trauma, number of things, not combat related, also qualify for Wounded Warrior. So just that's a big foot stomp too. It's more than what you might traditionally think of when we talk this term. So next slide, if you have airmen that are in those situations that you want to make sure they have additional support and resources, you can search on Wounded Warrior, and in that box there, refer an airman, and also you can self-refer. So when in doubt, refer, because again, they might not qualify, but even then we'll still do help and information referral. But if they are, they're going to get access to a lot of resources like those Wounded Warrior events that are going on. In fact, there's one at Scott next week. We have 120 wounded warriors that have participated in that, so that's awesome stuff. Next slide. And we're out on social media, like always. Next slide. We always put in a plug on this, SGLI and VRED. Do you guys know what this is as leaders? The importance of it? You see, we're a little bit better than Air Force average on the SGLI, but we're a little bit dragging on the VRED. Okay, annual requirement to go out and make sure that's right. If you have an airman that works for you that just got married, say, congratulations, have you upgraded your stuff? And here's why. Next slide. Take a look at that. Those are two cases just in the last year. Has anybody ever seen stuff like this happen or heard about it? I see some hands in the air. It's tragic. So what do you say, Chief Copeland? What do you always call it? What kind of leadership?
Intrusive
and analog leadership on this kind of stuff, because it's just tragic. And you know, we have the casualty operations there at AFPC that see this all the time. And so while we're out here on the roadshow, we just like to make a plug on it. And like it says, major life events, divorce, you don't want your ex-spouse getting this stuff, birth of child, changing of address, marriage, please use those as just a trigger. Go and update your stuff so it's accurate. So it says, God forbid anything happened to you. Next slide. Next slide. Another one we'd like to emphasize, has anybody done this? Transferred your benefits to your dependents? I see a couple of hands. Okay, yeah, great benefit. Wonderful recruiting and retention incentive that we have out there. Just a heads up for you and your airmen that come January of next year, January of 20, that if you have more than 16 years of service and you haven't yet transferred it, it'll be too late, because they want you to be able to serve that four-year service commitment in order to make that transfer, okay? So just be on the lookout for that if you're in that situation, or the airmen you lead are in that situation.
Ma'am, did I see an article that might be delayed?
So it was initially in July of this year. The suspense initially was 12 July of 19, and that was going to be cut off, right?
Okay.
And so you still have to have a four-year, but it was like if you had over 16, forget about it. They moved it to the January 20 timeframe to give us a little bit of extra time to beat the drums and get the word out. This is a DOD program, so you know it's all services play in this transfer benefit, but they gave us a little bit of extra time to continue to beat the drum on it. Because a few months ago, it was about 22,000 airmen that hadn't transferred their stuff yet that would be shut out, basically. And this is not a program we run. We're just kind of helping get the word out. Great question. Anything else? Okay, next slide. We had only, was it just one that I saw raise your hand that played in this process this year? Was it just you, sir? Okay, so just to give you a heads up, so for those of you that may not have participated this year but may be interested in future years, there is a nomination process, a central board now, and then matching where billet owners, that demo that he just did, billet owners and AU, AFID, USAFA, ROTC, all around the Air Force, are now billet owners that can put bids on people in the talent marketplace for this program, right? So that, did you put in your preferences? You did? Okay. And so now, I think next week, the billet owners will start seeing that you bid on, what did you bid on? A bunch of things. How many bids did you put in? Seriously? 12? 16? That's probably about right. We have had officers that put like 241 preferences out there. Chances are they got one of their preferences in the match. But yeah, that's probably about the sweet spot, right? Because you want to give enough options to find a good match, but not too many, right? Let's see. This is just all this is done is to elevate the importance of officer, instructor, and recruiting special duty across the Air Force, and the emphasis, and it didn't work, I will tell you. The number of people we had come in blind for this, 1,200 officers, applied for these different programs for only 370 requirements. So we had a lot of people come in that were nominated and that volunteered to do this, and that's great. Take ROTC, for example. Detachment commander, we usually get about 100 nominees, 100 people throw their name in the hat for that. This year we had 380 officers say, I want to be a ROTC deck commander under this process. That's goodness. That means that hopefully the quality of folks doing these important force generation jobs are have been elevated, and hopefully that'll continue to emphasize it through other ways, like, next slide, by including it on the officer selection brief and including it in the Secretary of the Air Force Memorandum of Instruction, MOI, that direction to the promotion board that says, hey, as an Air Force, we value these experiences.
And then we offer incentives, because in the past it's been challenging to get people to nominate for these. Deployment exemptions, alma mater preferences, follow-ons, and two-year assignments when the particular billet that they're volunteering for allows for that. So good stuff. I didn't want to talk too long on it because we only had one vote, but maybe next year when we do this annual call for this particular program, you'll know a little bit more about it and be watching for it. Yes?
I have a quick question. Are there certain AFSCs that are not allowing officers to compete for death command for ROTC?
That's a great question. So there was no career field release as part of this process this year. So what we can, are you rated by chance? No, okay. What's that?
6'2".
6'2". You guys, come on down. Yeah. No, there's no limit on that. In fact, we, you guys, as a general rule, let a lot of folks go and play these different opportunities. You guys really have always valued it as a career field, actually. Not all career fields have, but we've seen every career field played in for this. We didn't do a yes-no vote at the front end. Everybody competed at the central board. And now that's up to the billet owners to put their bids in and what kind of officer they're looking for. In the months of September and October, we're going to be trying to match the billet owners, the officer preferences, what the units want in terms of what they're looking for attribute-wise. And we're going to be kind of make that sausage, you know, try to work that art in there and see what we can come up with good matches in September and October. And in terms of career fields, what we can't have is that we decimate a certain career field by allowing too many of them to go, right? So we're going to see how it comes out, and then we're going to have deliberate discussions with the functional assignment teams, with DT chairs, with the hiring authorities, with the owning wing commanders, and say, what's the right thing for this officer and for this career field? So it's going to be art on steroids in the months of September and October across the assignment floor. Great question. Okay, next slide. All right, I'm moving up here. What do you guys know about this? You guys written one yet? Do you want to hear up? Anybody? Anybody even seen it? Anybody had a draft one? No? Yes, ma'am. One year below the zone? Okay.
I was asked for the 9-1.
Oh, you were?
Well, so we did the 9-1-1,
and then we made the 9-1-1. Oh, really? Well, we don't want you to do that, generally speaking. Yeah, it's a two-line from here on out, so no, don't even allow anybody to drive tonight. It might have been just they weren't sure the guidance wasn't out yet, because that may be what happened with your case. But we're all in with the two-line across the board, regardless of AFSC. Okay? Two-line PRF. What are you guys hearing from your leadership? Did you meet anybody? No comments? Oh, too young, you don't have PRFs? Do you think your PRFs can be required for the major board this year? Anybody up for major this year? A couple of you? What are you guys hearing about that? Is a PRF can be required?
Yeah.
Well, I got an email today, and General Goldfein doesn't want to have anybody have to do PRFs for this one. That's what I'm hearing. So be on the lookout for that. It looks like they will not do it unless the individual has derogatory information in the record, or it's a do not promote type of situation. So that's what... that's what my email said, if I can believe that, which is good news, right? Yeah, that would be great, right? We don't have to write a PRF. That'd be great. But generally speaking, so maybe for this crowd, yes, ma'am?
Can I do say no PRF for all majors?
Yeah, so if there's a personnel services delivery memorandum for every board that comes out and gives the guidance in that. They're going to actually edit the line of the Air Force Majors Board memorandum. They're going to make the edits based on the information we just got from General Goldfein. So it's hard for me because we're literally out on the road. I got this email while we were in the enlisted brief. Okay, because it said this, but I feel we're trying to be as transparent as possible with you, and it's great news, at least I think. So I wanted to share it with y'all. So what this has done is this is meant to take out, what are some of the bad things about the old one that you guys may have heard, even if you haven't written one? What are some of the bad things?
Buzzwords.
A lot of time. And what did you say, buzzwords?
Buzzwords.
Yeah, like there's some mystery out there, like there was the magic formula to get somebody promoted, right? Some sort of method, C method, all that kind of stuff, right? Now, is that what promotion should be about? No, it should be about performance, right? What else have you heard about the old one?
So I did some time with the wing exec, and
folks just, they paid attention to a couple of things on it. They paid attention to, what do you think, on the PRF? Whether they got a P or a DP, right? Promote or definitely promote. They look at that, the promotion recommendation. They look at that bottom line. What was the stratification? What did that senior grader say about them at this time in their career? They would say that. And then a lot of the other stuff is also supposed to be in the record, right? That's the theory. So they would go straight to the record. And so why are we doing all this if we don't need to? If the promotion results of a 9-line and a 1-line was tested, did you guys hear about that? They actually tested that. And the results were statistically and significantly different, right? So why are we going through all this? And we want to change this whole secret formula, all this other stuff, and go to a clear voice by the senior rater to the promotion board, and then the intent is for them to get into the record and make the determination based on performance, right? We don't have them push for jobs or for developmental education on this thing anymore, although it used to be before, because there's another process for that, right? There's other things that we use. This is for promotion, so let's just focus on that, okay? There's very strict rules on PRF stratification, different than officer performance report stratification. It's different at this point. Next slide. There's authorized peer groups, right? So you have the first stratification on the bottom line is what, how you stand amongst your eligible, other eligibles in that zone, right? So I'm number one of 15 below the zone eligibles. Or I'm number two of 15 in and above the zone eligibles. Those are the two categories. That's primary stratification. If you do that, if the senior rater does that, then they're allowed to do a secondary stratification in these authorized peer groups by Air Force grade, joint grade, command position, or duty position. And that is it. The rest of the two-line peer rep is used to describe this clear voice from the senior rater to describe why or why not you should be promoted. Okay? Pretty clear. Anybody have any questions on this? No? Okay, great. Next slide. Just a quick plug on this. If you or one of your folks get non-selected for promotion, there's this thing called officer non-select counseling. I do this for lieutenant colonels that have been non-selected for colonel. And what we do is we do an assessment of the individual's record that got non-selected for promotion and compare it to those that did get promoted and give an idea, insight as to why we think that their record didn't get promoted. Because it's not you not getting promoted, it's your record, really, right? Because you don't meet the promotion board, your record does. And what were the differences? Was something missing? Was something inaccurate? Duty title was wrong. Top up PR was missing, whatever. This is a chance for them to kind of find out a little bit of insight. So I just put that out there. It is a service we offer at AFPC. So take advantage of it if one of you or one of your folks fall into this category. Any questions? Okay, next slide. Go ahead and build this out. So since the officer, the line of the Air Force reconfiguration briefing didn't come to Whiteman Air Force Base, wanted to, I talked about that YouTube video that was out there, the 23-minute long video. We don't have time today to go into everything on this process, so I'm just going to give you a couple of points on it. Is that the reconfiguration, this developmental categories discussion that you may have been hearing about in the media, it's not a change to our current officer process per se. What is changing is the officers that you're grouped together with to be considered for promotion, right? Today, in the line of the Air Force, 80% of our officer corps is in it with over 40 different AFPCs, and that's who you're compared against. Under the proposed new process, you'll be broken into 6 different categories. Here. Have you seen this? Maybe? A couple of you have? Okay. So again, instead of this very large line of the Air Force developmental category, it'll be 6 separate developmental categories that I'll consider you. And it's, the idea behind it is that these, you have like developmental paths, and therefore you'll be, it's like comparing apples to apples, essentially, is what they've tried to do. They tested this out, and next week they're testing it again in a mock board format. The first mock board was to say, okay, guys, do these AFSCs make sense together? Do they have the same command opportunities? Do they have the same instructor duties? Do they have advanced academic degree requirements that are similar?
all similar? Do they have similar culture requirements? That's what the first mock board did. The second one that starts next week is going to actually compare results from a previous board to the one that they have next week and analyze what are the differences, why were they, what are any second, third order effects we hadn't considered. So they're doing going through this slowly to make sure we get it right.
Yeah.
So what he's talking about is promotion opportunity. Like today, the line in the Air Force has a promotion opportunity and it's set for that category. It gives the secretary the opportunity to change it based on the category, but initially I don't perceive, this is my opinion, and I don't, everything I'm hearing is initially they'll stay pretty constant, but it does give it down the road opportunity to make adjustments based on Air Force needs. Yeah. Good question. What else? Next slide. If you want that YouTube video I was referring to, it's that top link. Says for more information, that's where it's at. I encourage you to take a look at it. It's really good. And again, the link has, we have the script and the slides, everything you want to ever know about this particular proposed change. And it's not just this change, it's a part of a, go back, it's part of a larger strategy. Talent Marketplace, you've seen. OINRSD, we talked about as well. The PRF. Officer evaluation transformation is the last step. People talk about, are we going to redo the OPR? Are we going to have SCADs for officers? Maybe. They're actually, we're talking focus groups right now, looking at how can we change our OPR to make it more reflective of the future force that we need. And, you know, we'll see. I anticipate it will be aligned with our major graded areas for inspections, you know, managing resources, improving the unit, getting people, et cetera, executing the mission. Something more aligned with that, and also senior grader profiles might be coming. So these are things that are being discussed, but those won't be implemented until probably late next year. Okay, but it's all part of the grander strategy that's out there. So we have thrown a lot at you, and you guys have asked some great questions. How's the Pulse doing? You done?
Yeah.
You gotta finish it up. So if you have anything individually for anybody from the AFPC team, we'll go out into the hallway, because I believe we have a civilian coming in here next. In a few minutes. Thank you guys for coming. Thanks for your attention. Thanks for your time. Have a good day.